All right, good morning. I'll try to switch that off. Okay, good. Okay, so we were discussing about tunneling transport, and I mentioned it. This is a nice segue into the next topic that we want to pick up in this course on transport, which is this matrix version, which really takes into account the effect of contacts in a very nice way for electron transport. So, which is this non-equilibrium Green's function approach. And we're going to get started on that today. But before that, what I want to do is kind of, again, motivate the problem, just like we have done from the very beginning in this course. We have essentially the way, if you see how we have been dealing with things, is we'll say, here's an experiment. Here's experimental data. You cannot explain it using the older theories, so we need a new theory for it. So we develop the new theory, right? So that's essentially how we have been moving through the course. And I think today is kind of, we are 1 month into the course, which is roughly, I don't know, 1/4 or slightly less than that, more than that into the semester. I think probably today is the ninth lecture, and we have about 27 or 28, I forget exactly how many. What I want to kind of say also is, if you remember in the very beginning, we discussed that we will have projects in this course instead of the final exam. And I wanted to just remind you now that it's probably time to start talking to me about what might be the project and things like that. My goal would be to kind of pick up, for you to pick up something such that by the midpoint of the course, which is probably after the fall break, you should have something kind of a nice problem identified which you want to work on. So just wanted to remind myself as well as you about that aspect. So yeah. Okay, so and I've mentioned that getting back to the specific here, I'd mentioned that there is this very interesting, fascinating connection between the WKB and the Feynman path integral approach. And later on, probably after the fall break, we might have one class where we will spend looking at how, for example, Feynman path integral approach, what's the idea behind it, and then apply it to understand what is called, weak localization in the presence of magnetic fields, which is essentially the increase in resistance in some metallic conductors because of quantum interference and things like that. We'll see that, and that's very nicely captured in the Feynman path integral approach. And the other example I think I wanted to say was the WKB approach. If you remember, we started with an exact formulation of the transmission probability, which you had solved in your assignment, which again looked like so there was a V squared and things like that here. Yeah, the barrier potential squared over and then there's a sine hyperbolic squared times something like that, right? So that was this is exact. This was the exact formulation for transmit the tunneling probability through a barrier. And what I wanted to just make a quick connection to that again, lest we forget, is this is essentially the probability that a electron wave comes in, then kind of makes an attempt to go through, and maybe there's some success of going through here. Okay. Now this one short path, one direct path, is the WKB. Okay, so that's something we saw that under the approximations that this term is much larger than one and such. So you can actually reduce it into the WKB approximation when this term kind of comes up to the numerator, and it becomes KB times A. Right. So we had seen that in the last class. So what I want to say in pictures now, this is the probability that there's one shot. Electron comes in, makes an attempt to go through, and it can go through. So that's this probability. But this one, on the other hand, clearly is different from this. You can see there's a difference, right? And where is the difference coming from? And the difference is coming from the fact that it might make an attempt, but then it might actually scatter back, right? And then it might, when it hits this, it has a chance of getting out and then getting back in. You know? So it has all these multiple paths, right? That's possible, infinite number of them. And when you sum all of them, then you get that. It already takes care of that, right? Whereas if you just take one path, then you get this, right? So the analogy is this is your Feynman path integral, which also takes into account every possible path. You know? So all these are possible paths. In fact, it can get out and then get back in sometime and move. So that's also the physical connection there. And then we made a few other discussions. So I'll get back to this aspect of the story later on. So the thing we were talking about was developing a way to get to a current measurement. Typically what we are measuring is not so much the directly the probabilities as much as the current, be it in a semiconductor, in a tunneling diode, resonant tunneling diode, or scanning tunneling microscope. You're always measuring a current in response to some voltage. So that's why we are trying to write the expression for current. And what we are doing in the last class was developing a very kind of back of the envelope way of understanding how to calculate current. And the picture we had in mind was I have a semiconductor with a certain voltage applied across it. It's a PN junction, a PIN sort of junction where all these states are filled. And what we found was an expression for the WKB tunneling probability for an electron from the valence band to get out from the conduction band on the other side. And that was given by an exponential of minus some parameters that characterize the semiconductor. For example, the band gap, the effective mass, and the electric field. So those three were the major things, the band gap, the effective mass, and the electric field in the junction. And how did things depend on it? So there was some constant, a numerical constant in front, which were, square root of 2, 2 root 2 by 3, and all these other things. And then there were these dependencies that the effective mass appears as a square root, band gap to the power 3 halves, over electron charge, Planck's constant, and then the electric field. So that was kind of the WKB result for a gapped material. And now it turns out that for semiconductors, there's also a very strong connection between the band gap and the effective mass. And if you have done in the solid state physics any sort of K dot P sort of band structure picture, you'd realize that the whole reason why band structure develops is because, if I have an electron state in the conduction band and an electron state in the valence band, they actually interact with each other, right? If you have so you can consider this free electrons, but they interact with each other through the periodic potential of the crystal. So if you have when states interact with each other, they always repel. They never attract. So they always repel. This is a perturbation theory result, and therefore, if they're not moving, if the k is zero, they're at a certain energy. If you increase the k, the interaction or the repulsion increases. And so this state will go here, and that state will go there. Increase k further, so I'm plotting now k's versus e's, okay? Band structure. So they repel more and more, and then basically what it forms is it curves like that, because of repulsion, because of k's. This is one way to look at the perturbation theory result, right? So, and you get EK diagram, you get curvature in the band, and you develop effective mass and all that stuff. So what I'm trying to say really is if you look at that sort of theory, what you'll realize is effective mass for most semiconductors, for at least in the conduction band, is very closely related to the band gap. And in numbers, it goes as effective mass is band gap in electron volts over 20. This is a very nice result, very simple result, rough order of magnitude, rule of thumb. So you take gallium arsenide has a band gap of 1.4 electron volts, and the effective mass is about 0.07. So this is kind of, effective mass meaning the ratio with the free electron mass. That's what it means. So if you increase the band gap from gallium arsenide at 1.4 to roughly 3 times of gallium nitride, that's 3.4 eV, the effective mass becomes roughly 3 times. So, you know, it becomes about 0.2 from 0.07 becomes 0.2. So this is a, and then this comes out roughly. So in reality, you can, what I'm trying to say is this, even this effective mass is related to the band gap, and you can see it becomes exponential with a square of the band gap here. Square root here, and it becomes square of the band gap. And then there's some other numerical factors inside. Okay, so that is one of the other connections that you can look at it that way. And the current, on the other hand, was calculated by saying that, kind of a semi-classical picture is how often are electrons incident at this junction or at the barrier. And if you can find how often, what is the frequency of electrons that are incident at the barrier, then I can take that frequency and multiply it by the turning probability and get my current. I mean, that was one of the ideas. And just so that, to make a connection where that sort of picture comes from, let me just say, if I do that, then I get that the pre-factor here, which multiplies with the tunneling probability, has E squared by H, which has we can remind you of your quantized conductance, times A0 is kind of the lattice constant of the semiconductor, and NV is the valence band density of states. You know, so valence band, which is the source of electrons here. Valence band density of states. At least qualitatively, again, it can make some sense. If the valence band density of states is high, there are more electrons kind of incident at that interface, and that's the idea. And this is the voltage, which defines what is the window over which this current flows. And the voltage should be clear. It's essentially like a F left minus F right. So it's the window over which the current is flowing. And this picture comes from many ways. So for example, this is a problem you can also solve that I have a potential profile that looks like this, okay? And I have an electron that's sitting in a 1D, or you can think of it in 3D as well. I have an electron sitting in a quantum well that looks like this, okay? Right? And then I come in, so it's an infinite wall here, and I have a finite wall on the right side, finite potential barrier. And then I come in and apply an electric field. When you apply an electric field, this will become like that, right? And then you can ask how long is the electron going to stay here, right, after I apply the electric field, because it's a quasi-bound state now. It's not a bound state. And then the same picture, and this is maybe I can ask you as an assignment problem. You can calculate it exactly in the same way that you can think of this state was kind of a bound state, before we did all that, and there were part of the wave function going to the right, part of it going to the left. Think of it that way, right? And then that will immediately tell you what is the frequency at which you are colliding with the wall. Right? So another way to look at it is remember this is ground state kinetic energy goes as h square. If I have a wavelength which is the well width, if the well width is LW, then so the wavelength would be the ground state wavelength would be twice of the well width, right? So the ground state wavelength, and therefore the K vector would be 2 pi over twice of the well width, right? And over 2m, so that would be the kinetic energy. What would be the velocity, effective, classical velocity, you can kind of figure out from here. You can say it's half mv squared, is something like this, right? That will give a classical velocity. And the width of the well, velocity divided by width of the well will be a frequency, or factors of 2, give and take, right? Does that make sense? So you can calculate the frequency, and then if you find your WKB, you can calculate how long will this take. And if you look at this problem, it's exactly the same problem that you have in a slightly different way, which is if you have a hydrogen atom, okay, and you have an electron that is tied to it, right? Electron that's tied to it, and you put it in an electric field, and you come in, and the electric field takes the potential, and it does it like that, right? The same problem, exactly. So you can from here estimate how long will it take for you if you apply a large enough electric field to strip out an electron from a hydrogen atom, the time it takes to ionize a hydrogen atom. It's the same problem. And you can kind of extend it in many, many ways. For example, you can take a silicon ballistic MOSFET, as we have talked about so often now. I can take a ballistic MOSFET, and then I have a source of electrons, I have a drain of electrons, I have p-type silicon, and then here I have an oxide barrier, but then on it I have a metal, right? And what I can do is, inside this oxide barrier, I can suspend some little islands of metal, very small islands of metal. It could be like that, it could be a whole slab of metal, very thin metal. And then if I look at this situation, and you draw the band diagram across this direction, you'll see it starts looking very much like that. What will happen there is you can apply a large field, and you can kind of tunnel electrons into this island. Okay? And then when you release the field, the electron stays there for a relatively long time. Then if you want to pull that electron out, if electron stays here, what it does is it shifts the threshold voltage of this device, electrostatically. Yeah. And then if you want to move that electron out, you apply a field again and you tunnel it out. Does that make sense? And that's the basis for flash memory. You know, flash memory, which is the memory in whenever you say my laptop has 8 gig of memory, that is this flash memory. So it has this metallic islands or metallic slabs where you kind of push in electrons just using exactly this mechanism. So using quasi-bound states and tunneling in and tunneling out. So basically what you'll see is given a certain field, which is equilibrium field, let's say it's sitting under a certain field already, it might take you 20 years to tunnel out. But if you apply a voltage of 4 volts or so, it will take you about a millisecond. You can change it from 20 years to a millisecond. And why can you change it? Because of the field is sitting in the denominator. It's such a strong function of field, right? So does that make sense? I mean, that's the game. So flash memory, it's a quasi-bound state, which is, how long will it take at a field of, say, maybe half a mega, let's say 100 volt, kilovolt per centimeter, it might take you 20, 30 years. That's how long the memory will work if you leave it alone. But if you just apply a small voltage, you reduce that to milliseconds, and then you can read out. Okay, so that's an interesting application of this problem of tunneling. Okay. And I might ask you one or two of these in your assignment paper. Okay, so the next topic I'll do is just discuss a little bit more on some details of tunneling, going beyond this very, very rough back of the envelope picture, I again want to emphasize that you can go pretty far with back of the envelope. So you can do quite a bit of analysis back of the envelope as well. But looking at a more realistic situation, if I look at a three-dimensional p-n junction like what I have there, instead of looking at a 1D p-n junction, if I have three dimensions and I have a band energy diagram that looks like this. Then if I look at an energy state of electron that's coming in from the left, let's say at this state of energy, okay. And when it's coming in, its actual, let's say this electron that's moving to the right, it is electron energy state that is a part of the EK diagram of the band structure, right? And if you remember, so the energy of the valence band is given by valence band edge, which is EV. And let's write it EV, valence band edge, which is this energy level, on the P side. Okay. Let's label it this way. It's on the P side. Because EV on the N side is here. Okay. So we can label these things like that. EC on the N side and EV on the, EC of the P side. Right? This is the P-N junction. Right? So I'm going to write it EV on the P side. Let's say I'm just writing it on the P side right now, minus the kinetic energy. Okay, so, and that would be 2 times effective mass of the valence band, which is the curvature. I'm going to assume an isotropic effective mass where, the mass, effective mass is really a tensor, but for simplicity right now, let's assume it's isotropic. You don't have to. You can assume any non-isotropic version you want. And then it will have k. Now this momentum of the electron it's a three-dimensional solid. Okay, so when an electron comes in from the left side, the picture I want to draw, if I want to draw, you know, for example, somewhere there, I can draw a k-space picture of the electrons that are moving in the valence band. So I can draw that, and here's my x direction. Okay. That's the x direction. So if the electron is moving in the x direction, its momentum h bar k is in the x direction. This is, let's say, y, and this is z. This is the lateral momentum. Right. So if I'm looking at this energy, for example, at this point in space, then I have this much kinetic energy. Consider, right? This much kinetic energy. And the valence band edge state sits here. I mean, in the k-space, I'm drawing it this way. Valence band edge state has no kinetic energy, so it's at k equal to 0. Right? And then you fill up states all the way to this energy, and that means I have, well, some sort of a sphere. You can see that right here, right? It's a 3D, so you have carriers moving to the left, to the right, you know, in all directions. They're moving towards x, minus x, in y, z, all directions. They're moving in all directions. So you have this sort of a sphere of states in the k-space that are... And what is the radius of that sphere? Can we actually say what is the radius of the sphere? I mean, here you can see I have kx squared, ky squared, plus kz squared, right? That's my total kinetic energy. So this term is the total kinetic energy. It's kind of flipped around, right? So, well, I'm saying what we are plotting there is really this equation in some sense. I mean, these are the states that are so at each k point, associated with each k point is energy, right? Energy of the electron, and this is the equation for that energy. Right? This is the connection you can make. And so if you ask what is that radius of the sphere, then clearly it's determined by what is this energy, right? Does that make sense? I mean, that the energy will determine what is the radius of that sphere. In fact, from here, you can write it, you know, this minus this, and take a square root, and you'll get the radius from here, right? More is the energy, bigger is the sphere, right? That's also clear, right? So more is the energy, bigger is the sphere. Now, out of these states, I'm going to actually draw, so this is obviously a sphere, so I'll try to draw let's say, you know, the top of the sphere is somewhere there, the north pole, and then you can draw on the sphere, you know, right-going hemisphere. Right? You can draw a right-going hemisphere. Right? And those electrons are moving to the right. And then on this side are those states moving to the left. And what we want to do now is look at it for two things. First is the tunneling probability of an electron at this k state. You know, and you can see right away that where will the electron start tunneling? And this is kind of where it gets very interesting, because you see this electron that is kind of far from the junction, you know, still far from the junction, right? This electron can, you know, and this electron, for example, when I say this electron, it may be sitting, you know, somewhere, you know, so let's say this is the right-going state. Let's say somewhere there. I'm not being very particular, somewhere there. It's moving to the right, but maybe at an angle, you know, it still has some lateral momentum as well. You know? Now, that electron has a certain finite probability for kind of disappearing from here and appearing somewhere on the right. Still has a finite probability. It's non-zero. But we'll see right away, for this one, it's very, very low. So the question is always how much. Because you see, for this electron, it's still a tunneling problem. You know? For what is it seeing? It's seeing a barrier that is this big, right? You see that? It's seeing a barrier that's that big. All these states are filled, so it really cannot kind of, you know, climb up there. And it's seeing a barrier that's also kind of, you know, at least this long. You know, it has to go across here, and then it can come out on the other side. Right? But when I say at least, you'll see what I'll try to convince you is even this is not allowed for this. We'll see it has to come out somewhere here. Even this is not allowed for it. And the reason for that is the tunneling process. In the tunneling process, the electron is going to conserve, the way we are looking at it, it's an elastic process, so it's going to conserve energy, so it's always at the same energy, but it's also going to conserve momentum. So energy and momentum are both conserved. But you look at the x direction, there is a huge electric field. There's a huge electric field, and I think you know from classical mechanics as well as quantum mechanics, if there's electric field, it changes the momentum. You know, rate of change of momentum is equal to force, right? So the momentum in the x direction is not going to be conserved, because there's a force. But in the lateral directions, it should be conserved, because in lateral direction, there's no field, right? If it's a three-dimensional problem. And you can see, you can change it to a 2D problem, and there will be only one lateral dimension, right? And in 0D, there is no lateral dimension. In 1D, there's no lateral dimension, just one direction. So the lateral part of the momentum is going to be conserved. And another way to look at it, so what does that mean? It means that if an electron comes out from here, out of this total kinetic energy, part of it is directed in the x direction, right? But the other part of it is lateral, right? Ky and kz is lateral, and this part of it is not going to change. The momentum of it is not going to change. H bar. So what I'm trying to say is lateral momentum conservation means that H bar times kx. Ky times y direction vector plus kz times z direction vector. Ky on the p side, after tunneling, when the electron comes out on the right side, ky on the n side, y plus kz on the n side, z. So not just the the magnitude of the lateral momentum, also the direction. Does it make sense? Because, if it was moving along ky in the y direction on the p side with this much, it must also, it's a vector equality, meaning it's actually two of them in the Cartesian coordinates. What does it mean? It means that if this is the left side and on the right side, I'm looking at the conduction band states now, not the valence band, but the conduction band states, and then I can start labeling them as kx, let's say on the p side, p, and kx on the n side, kz on the inside, ky on the inside, right? So if an electron comes out, let's say some state inside this sphere, for example. The ones on the, if that one tries to come out, then that particle has a certain x-directed momentum, a certain y-directed momentum, and a certain, you can see that for this particular electron, there is kx, there is ky and kz. It's all three components, and so you can kind of draw another circle around this kx point. Not being very accurate here. Let me do it a little better because it's getting a little confusing here. Okay, so here's the state. That's going to the right, and let's say the x component of it is kind of here. This is the x part of it, and it has a y and a z. Right? Z. Right? This is kx. So I can take this point and draw another circle around it, right? And you can see that now the lateral momentum z part and y part form a vector that looks like that. So what I'm trying to say is when that electron comes out after tunneling on this side, its lateral momentum should be exactly in the same direction. So it cannot change. Yeah? It cannot change the angle. It should come out at the kind of the same. So whatever be the x angle, but the yz angle should come out like that. That's the lateral momentum conservation. And if you enforce that, one way to enforce that is essentially you can start by saying energy conservation. So energy conservation will require this to come out on that side, right? And qualitatively, you can see that if I have no lateral momentum, if I have no ky and kz, then I have all my kinetic energy is in kx. So that's the point at the tip of this sphere on the right side where I have no lateral momentum. That is the fastest moving electron in the x direction. Not only that, it is incident on your barrier at right angles. So intuitively, you can see right away it has the highest probability of tunneling. Right? because all the momentum is directed in that direction, and it has the highest potential for tunneling. And you can see, even make a classical picture with it. You know, if you have light incident perpendicularly, it has the highest transmission. If you turn it at a slight angle, there's a lot of reflection. You go further, at some point, there's total internal reflection or something. Or actually, if you're going for light, depends on the media, right? As you turn the angle, and exactly like that, as you go to higher angles here, these states are incident on the wall at a very small angle, and they have much higher chance of getting reflected back. I mean, that's the picture. Right? So qualitatively, at least, you can see right away that even the tunneling probability, not just which electrons are going to tunnel, even the tunneling probability will depend on the total energy. And what we will see now is, instead of just this factor, there will be another factor that will look like, you know, lateral energy perpendicular to the, I don't know how we phrase this, maybe parallel and perpendicular. Yeah, parallel to the wall over some other E naught. Let me just say, so there will be an exponential. What I'm saying is that tunneling probability for the states that are incident at an angle, there's an exponential damping of the tunneling probability itself. The tunneling probability itself is exponentially damped. You know? And the reason for that, you'll see now, is because in the WKB picture, you can actually glean it out from there directly. So in the WKB picture, the total, you know, this integral that you do, in the action integral, that is the total, kinetic minus the potential energy, right? Kinetic energy minus the potential energy. And here, what you actually need in the WKB is not the total kinetic energy, but only the x-directed, only the direction that in which the transport is occurring. As a result, the lateral part of the kinetic energy goes into, let me just say what I mean by that. So, maybe I don't want to erase that. So let me erase this. Yeah. So again, if I'm incident at various angles, you can see now the probability is changing. And the way to deal with that is, if you remember, we said WKB was e to the power minus twice the action integral, and the action integral, which is essentially from x1 to x2, is this square root, right? Of dx, and then it was v minus e, right? V of x minus the e. Right? But what I'm trying to say now is because of this lateral momentum conservation, what k's are allowed? Rather, okay. So v minus e is going to look like this will be the total. Initially, we had the total energy, but now it will become total minus this e. What is the terminology I've used? The lateral versus parallel, right? Keep forgetting. Yeah, parallel. Okay. So, parallel. So, this part of the kinetic energy. So, let me write this down. EVP minus 8 square kx square by 2m star v minus, I mean, whatever is directed at right angles to the wall, this we are referring to as E parallel. It's the energy. You can see energy has no direction, but I think the physical meaning is clear. It's the momentum that has the direction. And the part of the kinetic energy that's contributing to the lateral direction is the part we're calling as, it's just a notation. Energy is not a vector. It doesn't have, So from here, you can see essentially all that happens is this E parallel kind of adds to the V naught. I mean, if your barrier height is V naught, it becomes a little larger, right? And physically, again, if your particles are incident at an angle, you know, it has more reflection. I mean, that's just the intuitive picture for it. And the other end of the spectrum is, I told you, here is an electron at this point which moves, completely to the x. It has no lateral momentum. But then at that particular energy also, there are electrons that are here. Oh, sorry, what am I saying? That I already talked about, that are here. So that electron has the same energy. It's at this energy. But it has no chance of tunneling because it's going, you know, like that. It's not going like that, right? And for that, the tunneling probability is pretty much zero. I mean, there's no question. The question doesn't arise because it's not even going in the right direction, right? Does that make sense? So you have to sum all of that to find the total current. So each k point we find what is the tunneling probability for that k point, right? Times what is the groove velocity and all that. And I think you know this by now, FL minus FR, you know, and you sum this over all k states, that's your total current, right? You find the tunneling probability of each k point, find all the k points that are in this little, you know, here, sum them, and that's your total current now. Does that make sense? I mean, that's the procedure. We've used that a couple of times. And this procedure now, essentially what it will do is e to the power minus 2. What it'll do is it will give you your WKB with no lateral momentum. So instead of EG to the power 3 halves, let me write it instead of trying to hurry through this because this is important, over 3Q H bar field. And then it was EG to the power 3 halves, right? And what I'm trying to say is this EG now, you know, after all is said and done, this EG becomes a EG plus H square, you know, K Y square plus K Z squared over 2 times effective mass. You know? So it just becomes, instead of just the band gap, it becomes that. It just so happened in one dimension, there was no KY and KZ, which is why we got what we got earlier. Now you have KY and KZ as well. So you have to take care of that. And then you take this 3 halves power and do a little Taylor series and you split it into 2 exponentials. You know, you pull out, you say that, yeah, my lateral kinetic moment energy is not very high. In fact, what it will end up happening is your tunneling probability, when you split it with this little Taylor series, it will become minus E parallel, which is this quantity, over some other constant, is what I'm trying to say. So the lateral directed energies, lateral directed electron states are exponentially damped in tunneling. You know, they're not. Does that make sense? So they're exponentially damped, and as a result of that, what's going to happen then is the electrons that are going to really make it. You can now intuitively start thinking that, well, this electron has a very high groove velocity, right, and it also has a very high tunneling probability. Right. So it's going to have the highest chance of tunneling. I mean, it'll contribute the most. This one has it has no chance. Right. So the ones out of the left are going to the left. There's no chance of tunneling for them. And those, as you increase the lateral momentum, the tunneling probability is going down exponentially. Right. So as a result, you can kind of start seeing that what are the states that are actually contributing to tunneling. And you'll see that they will form some, you know, some sort of a collimated state like that. You know? Those are the ones that dominate, right? That are mostly extra-directed. And then as you move away from this at a characteristic energy scale of this much E naught, it gets damped out. Right? So you have this collimation. Yeah. And you can see that as a result, the 1D is kind of the best situation in some sense, because then all the states are, you know, are doing the best, right? As you go to larger and larger dimensions, you kind of lose that sort of collimation nature of it. So I can take that, let me just go through this one process again. So on the slides that I'm about to post, there are a few approaches to calculating the WKB, but all of them kind of lead to the same sort of conclusion that I mentioned, that if you have the intuition that the lateral momentum will be damped stronger, that's the main thing, really. And the other things are not as new. So based on this, what we can now say is what is the... So if I know my tunneling probability, if I know, then how do I find my current? And then that we have already kind of discussed quite a few times, that you sum over all these group velocities and the transmission probability. But what I'm trying to ask now is, what are those k states over which I should sum, right? Because clearly, from here, as we discussed, the k states going to the left are not really. And so how do I sum? What are the k states? And for that, you just say that what is the valence band state energy here should be equal to the valence band conduction band state energy when it comes out on the right side. So EV on the p side minus 8 squared by 2 times effective mass of valence band, kx on the, let's write it, kx p side, ky on the p side plus kz on the p side. It's very simple. I mean, I'm just going to conserve energy. So energy in the valence band here is equal to energy when it comes out. So when it comes out on the right side here, you see, you know, the energy will be there. So those two energies must be the same, right? So we just say that. And what is that energy? It's the conduction band edge on the N side plus the kinetic part, which is 8 squared over 2 times. Now, here's an important thing. It's the effective mass of the conduction band now, not the valence band, right? On the right side. It's the conduction band effective mass. And then you have kxn squared, kyn squared, plus kzn squared. Right? That's the energy conservation. I mean, it's straightforward, but you right away see that the masses that appear are different. Now, because of lateral momentum conservation, what you realize is, so let me just transform this a little bit. Take EVP, rather I'm going to take, you know, this to the left and this to the right and rearrange it in a way that looks like this. 8 square over 2m star of V. You can see there's a minus and plus, so when I switch them around, all of them will have plus signs on one side, right? So that's what I'm trying to do, plus. So, So let's see. Do you see that these two should be the same if I want to conserve lateral momentum, right? Because each kyp is equal to kyn. Is that correct? I mean, they have to be the same. H bar times k is the lateral momentum. So they are the same. And therefore, what you end up getting here is an interesting aspect, which is m star c plus m star v. You know, when I take this to this side, you see you get 1 over m star c plus 1 over m star v. So that's what we call the reduced effective mass, k, y, and I don't need to write n and p anymore because they are the same, right? On the n and p sides, they're the same. So I get that. So I've written up the x-directed energies and the y-directed energies. And on the left side, what I have is EV on the p side minus EC on the n side. Is that correct, what I wrote here? Yeah. EV on the n side. Is that okay? So now, when I did not apply a bias, let's say, you know, I had doped it just about right, and if you're, you know, take the dopings, you know, so the EC and EV were just about aligned, let's say. You can mismatch it, and that's not a problem. You just introduce a little shift in the voltage. But if they were just aligned at zero bias, then all the shift in the EC is because of the applied voltage, right? And that's just Q times V. So what I'm trying to say is the left side is just Q times V for us. That's how much the bands were pulled down when you applied a voltage across it. And that equals now 8 square. This quantity, we're going to call it 1 over the reduced mass, you know, 1 over m star r. So 8 square by 2 times reduced effective mass, ky square plus kz square, right? Plus 8 square kx on the p side square. 8 square k x on the n side square over twice effective mass of conduction band. So this is kind of the result that you have here. And so by now you realize we have conserved both energy and momentum. You know, that's how we ended up here. So this equation takes care of both of those quantities. And what it is telling you is already that telling you some information that if I apply a voltage V, all the k's that satisfy this equation are allowed to turn. That's what it's telling you. This is kind of defining what are the case studies you should be looking at, right? Makes sense. And right away you can see if you take V to zero, no case states are allowed to turn, right? Because, you know, all the k's are k squared, so there's nothing can cancel with anything else. So and that's just saying that I've shrunk my sphere that I talked about to zero. There's no state left, right? So the radius effectively of that sphere is determined by the voltage you're applying, right? Actually, does that make sense? As you increase the voltage, you allow more k states to turn. And one way to also look at it is, another way to look at it is just say that, look, for an electron to come out on the right side, it can obviously conserve lateral momentum. As long as kx on the n side is greater than or equal to zero, I'm good. I mean, my electron is kind of just about made it, right? That's one way to look at it, right? So h bar times k is the momentum. So as long as x on the n side is greater than or equal to zero, I'm good, right? I mean, the electron has already tunneled through. So as a result, you can say that this term must be greater than or equal to zero, and that now really tells you what is this region in k-space that you should look at for tunneling. So that tells you very clearly. So you can now make that the subject of your equation if you want to say it that way. And I'm actually going to not go through this derivation because I wanted to ask you to try your hand at solving it. And that essentially gives you a very nice little, relationship between k's and angles and all that. And that allows you to analytically completely calculate the current for the situation. So you get a complete analytical solution for this problem for the 3D. And what you notice in the end is a couple of things. Let me just write those things down. I'm not trying to derive it. I think I've already spent quite a time pointing out the procedure. But yeah. So this will tell you what are the k-states you should consider in your sum over k-space to calculate current. And this is telling you what is the tunneling probability you should use for each k-state. Just multiply and sum, right? Or integrate. Okay. So. After you do that, the tunneling current expression you're going to get has these interesting quantities that I wanted to make some physical connection to q over h bar. Yes, you can pull out. So there's a h bar, I think. H bar and pi h bar squared, right? M star. Okay, so let's just there are some constants that I'm really trying to not get into that aspect right now. There's the tunneling probability for perpendicular incidence, which is this perpendicular incidence that sits as a prefactor, and then there's this lateral a characteristic lateral energy that comes out E parallel, which again depends on the field and the band gap and masses. In basically, it's kind of the flipped version of this. I mean, if you remember square root of it, all these parameters, mass and band gap and the electric field determine that parameter. And then the voltage dependence is what I wanted to kind of get to. It has charge times voltage, QV minus some this other term which looks E parallel, and then 1 minus E to the power, some E to the minus QV by 2. Okay, so 2 E parallel. So that's the total expression for the current in 3D. So just as a in picture, so this is the perpendicular incidence tunneling probability, and here's essentially, this whole quantity out here is this quantity has units of voltage, as you can see, or energy. And here's an energy and Q over H bar. Now, this quantity, can you identify what this is? This is an interesting, once you end up with this. Do you know what that quantity is? M by pi H bar square. Have you seen this? In any solid-state physics or courses like that. Mass by pi h bar squared. Okay, so this is actually the two-dimensional density of states. If you have a two-dimensional system of electrons, the density of states is mass by pi h bar squared in 2D. Right? If you have a parabolic band and you have a 2D system, this is the density of states. And you ask the question, why is it sitting in the front? Why is there a density of states in the front? And the reason for that is it's just kind of looking at it in a way that you have your source function all these k states. So all these, it's kind of sliced it up into many of these k states. And so each of them is kind of a 2D thing. So the source function, so it's essentially, this is the lateral density of states, if you might. I mean, so for example, a circle of states here, and so these are because you're tunneling in one direction, the lateral direction is kind of your source function, and that's why it appears. I mean, this is qualitatively at least. So what I'm trying to say is, if you go from 3D to 2D, you will see there will be a 1D density of states sitting in the front. Does that make sense? I mean, so as you change the dimensionality, there'll be a 1D density of states sitting in the front, you know, if you go 3D to 2D. And that's, again, because you have these slices of energy in K-space that are incident on it. And if you look at this expression here on voltages, if your voltage is relatively large compared to this, you just get a linear relation, just Q times V. And so the current is linearly proportional to the voltage. That looks like Ohm's law almost, right? But it's clearly not Ohm's law. So if the voltage is much larger than this characteristic energy, and you can find that energy based on the semiconductor and the field, right, what material you have. If it's larger, then your current becomes, you know, all these quantities in the front times voltage. And so IV, current versus voltage, is linear, and this is very much desired for devices, in semiconductor devices, especially for ohmic contacts, and you're making lasers and solar cells. If you're making solar cells which have two bands of absorption, one absorbs in the blue, the other in green, you need to connect the two. So you need a tunnel junction between the two. And this is what you need. You need a linear resistance and a very small drop of resistance. So you do everything there possible to, you know, make this quantity in front of the voltage, which is, you know, your conductance, right, as large as possible. And you can see you choose the smallest. By first looking at it, you might say, oh, I want to choose a large effective mass, but you have to be very careful because there's exponential factor T naught sitting there, right? And so that pretty much dominates what you choose. You want a small band gap, you want a high field, and you want small effective mass. That will allow you to have the lowest resistance and allow it. So this is also very important for these tunneling transistors, or TFETs, that I'll just briefly talk about a little bit later today. Okay? Now, on the other hand, if your voltage is much smaller than this lateral kinetic energy, which appears here, then you can expand this out again, and then you will see the linear terms will cancel, and what will survive is a square term. So the voltage square will survive now. And now it's a nonlinear function, right? And this is a very interesting nonlinear function because remember what we are looking at right now is the reverse bias current of a p-n junction. And it's the reverse bias current of a p-n junction. So what I was trying to say is, in the first case, I versus V. So a normal p-n junction looks, something like that, right? Normal p-n junction curve looks something like that. Forward bias is diffusive with no tunneling. This is how it is, drift diffusion transport. The moment you turn on tunneling, what we calculated is actually true for reverse bias. So if the first condition, you make sure that you have a large enough tunneling probability and choose things right. So this device, so in that linear scale, actually I should make it a little more accurate. In a linear scale, it will look very low, very low, and then it will turn on at a certain VBI, right? Will turn on it, so close to the band gap of the semiconductor. That's where it turns on in the linear scale. Now, in the linear scale, that curve, once I turn on the tunneling current, will look like this. It will actually turn on in the reverse bias. So if I turn on the tunneling in the reverse bias in the first case, so it will look like this. So it will actually, within this window, it will flip around what you think of a diode. The diode will turn on under reverse bias, but it will turn off in the forward bias, the opposite of a normal diode. So this is called a backward diode. A backward diode, and it's extremely useful for millimeter wave imaging and things like that. You can see why it's called a backward diode. It's conducting more current in reverse bias than forward bias now, right? If you ensure, if you design it right. And in the second case, instead of linear, what I'm trying to say it becomes parabolic, or some other nonlinear function. It also turns on faster in reverse bias. And whenever you have this sort of a nonlinearity and curvature here, this is also very useful for ultra-fast detectors and things like that. So in many millimeter wave imaging applications, it's actually very useful. I think I'm kind of running a little late today, but what I want to say, so all this stuff we talked about is based on homojunctions, meaning the semiconductor here is the same as the semiconductor here. And you can kind of let it, you know, you can take away this simplification in many ways. You can first say that the semiconductor here has a larger band gap or a smaller band gap than the semiconductor there. That's one possibility. In fact, it can have different band alignments. You know, the bands may not be, they can be heterostructures. You can make one semiconductor three-dimensional, the other two-dimensional. You can do all kinds of things there. Right? So you can tunnel from a 3D system to a 2D system or 2D to 1D and all that stuff. So you can change dimensions, you can change materials, band alignments, all kinds of things. But after all is said and done, the current will still remain, what we have discussed. It will be, a sum over these states, and it will be some tunneling probability, and you have to evaluate it right. And then when you evaluate it, you make sure that you take care of the dimensions correctly here. If you are tunneling from 3D to 2D, then, well, you will not have one of the Ks in a 2D system. You have to just make sure that that happens, and then things will just work out. When you look at the expression for the current here, the evaluation of the sum, what it ends up doing is actually it multiplies the density of states of the two sides, you know, of this side and of that side. This is the density of states. A little more accurate way of looking at this, what is this? Okay. Why is this appearing here? Is you have valence band states that look like this, conduction band states that look like this. But really, these are three-dimensional paraboloids. You can see, I mean, there's a kx, ky, and kz. I'm drawing it in one dimension like this. And the states that can tunnel from here to there are ones when you intersect the two. Right? Does that make sense? You intersect the two, right? Paraboloids. And the intersection of two three-dimensional paraboloids is a circle, actually. It's a two-dimensional circle. That's what's appearing here. Simpler way to think about it, let's say we tunnel from 2D to 2D, a 2D to 2D, right? 2D to 2D. 2D has really a real paraboloid, in kx and ky. So kx and ky, energy versus k, looks like that. And on the valence band side, there's another paraboloid, which is flipped around, like that, right? And all the states are not living inside this, but on the surface of this paraboloid, right? So when you intersect it in 2D, you get a line. It's a circle. You see that? And that's this. That's what's contributing to the state sitting in the front. So right? And you can now think, what if I had a 3D to 2D and all this? So you get all these different geometric shapes, and then corresponding to that, there'll be a density of states sitting here. Correspond to that. Looked at that. So similarly, for the p-n junction now, you can take that, and you can now see what will happen in the forward bias direction, that if I instead of reverse bias, if I start applying forward bias, if I have doped it rather degenerately here, and I have electrons here, so there are empty states holes and electrons here, and when I increase it, these electrons can tunnel. That's a new feature from conduction band to valence band. That's different from the whole electrons tunneling from valence band to conduction band. So this part will contribute another blip. And the way to look at it is, again, you have a density of states here, density of states here. And as you apply the voltage, you're kind of sliding the two across each other. And it's a convolution. That's the accurate mathematical term. And when you look at the convolution of the two densities 3D, in the forward bias, you will get this. And that's why you get the IV curve. V is what is changing the density of states against each other. And the intersection points where tunneling is allowed is a circle or a ring or whatever we were talking about. And then that's kind of the area of that, in some sense. That's what it's changing with voltage. So it goes back up and goes down. Does it make sense? I mean, this picture here is from 3D to 3D. So what you really are looking at is a density of states that looks like this, and a density of states that looks, this is, let's say, P side, and then the N side is kind of here. Let's say you're better. Right. So this is tied to one battery potential. This potential is tied to another battery, and then you start applying voltage. And you can see, these two functions, as they slide against each other, you take a product, and you integrate over the all energies. That's convolution. And that's what we're plotting there. The IV curve is really a product of that. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to, I can spend, I mean, in some places, this whole semester is spent teaching about tunneling and other things, so I want to kind of stop here. There is one aspect of tunneling which I'll cover later, which is the time-dependent aspect. How do you think of it as, you know, instead of looking at time-independent Schrodinger, we look at time-dependent. I'll cover this part later. But what I want to do is come back to maybe just discuss a little bit about applications. I've already mentioned a few things here. So in applications, the first things were developed at least to understand what was called dielectric breakdown. Why do insulators break down and conduct a lot of current when you apply a large enough voltage? You know, that was Zener's original explanation of why insulators start conducting. And his idea was, well, if you have a large enough field, electrons tunnel out of the valence band into the conduction band on the other side. And that's how he started it. There are, as I said, so you can have a normal homogeneous semiconductor n-type. But you see here, the field you can apply is completely determined by the voltage you apply outside divided by the length. And because tunneling is exponentially dependent on the field, you have to apply very high voltages. Because of this very reason, if you have a very large band gap, it can sustain very high voltages and not tunnel. Right? So which is why large band gap semiconductors can sustain very high voltages across. That's one way to look at it. The truth of the matter is tunneling is not the only thing. There are other things like avalanche and other processes that kick in as well. You know? So we will look at the avalanche part when we start talking about diffusive transport. But here's the K-space picture. You have valence bands here, and you're tunneling to electron states. We've talked about this. So in a p-n junction, why did Isaki see tunneling in p-n junction first so clearly? It's because you have bumped up the field by a huge amount. You know, you use this built-in electric field because of dopants, because of dopant transfer. There's an internal field now, right, which can reach extremely high values. The more you dope, the higher is the field. Even at when you have not applied an external voltage, when external voltage is zero, you still have a field here, a huge one. Right? And the external voltage really does nothing much for you in a tunnel junction. It's mostly the internal field that is huge. You know? And you can choose, instead of a homojunction semiconductor, now you can have options of choosing what's called a broken gap or staggered gap semiconductor, where tunneling is extremely large because the alignment of bands is like this. The valence band states are here, conduction band states start here. Conduction band edge of one semiconductor is below the valence band edge of the other semiconductor. It's a broken gap semiconductor. And there you can see the tunneling probability. Actually, it's a very much different situation. I mean, it's hard to stop the tunneling in some sense, right? So here, so that's the way to look at this part. And then here the currents will be very much higher. Yeah. And here you can see there's a very interesting weird situation where the valence band electron states are mixed up strongly with the conduction, with a very strong coupling between the two. And this is also one of the recipes for getting these topological insulator states where you get, you know, mixture of the two bands, and people are looking at that. One of the topics to be covered in the, you know, last one third of the course. So, yeah. As we discussed for transistors, if you remember, we talked about ballistic transistors. When you're switching it off, we are stuck at the 60 millivolt per decade if you're going over the barrier, right? You have done that in your problems, and we discussed that there's this, when the off state of the transistor, you apply 60 millivolt to change current by a factor of 10, right? But with tunneling, when you go through the barrier, there's a lot of hope that you can actually go above. Rather, you can make it steeper or sub 60. And already for quite a few experiments, this has been demonstrated and observed. But if you remember, one of the issues was you just don't want to make it steeper. You also want a very high on current, because if you don't get a high on current, your performance is not very good, right? So that is still a challenge, meaning getting sub 60 off is not a problem. People can get it today. But getting the high on current with it is a challenge. And it's really not that surprising because, you know, you're tunneling, so tunneling currents are generally low, right? On currents are generally low. But this is the idea. Instead of, you know, remember the normal transistor had a source and a drain, which, you know, it was N plus P and N plus, but now you make a P-N junction injector here. You know, the source injector is a reverse biased P-N junction, Isaki or a Zener diode for you. Does that make sense? You are now, instead of pulling electrons in from conduction band and moving this barrier up and down, to control the current flow. What you're doing is, so here's the off state of the transistor, and then you have, so gate has, you know, essentially there's no tunneling because the tunneling barrier, electrons have to tunnel from here all the way till there, right? Very low current. Then what you could do is with a gate voltage, you put a little charge on the gate and you push this down a little bit. And then this band comes down and it aligns and your tunneling distance changes from here to there. So you turn on really fast, right? So that's the trick people are trying to do now and make these kind of interesting devices. And many materials are being looked at. And as you can see, as you go to narrower and narrower band gaps, for silicon is 1.1 eV, and germanium, InGaAs, and graphene, and others, you get more and more on current because of tunneling as you go to narrower and narrower band gaps. And all these things should be clear, but why? Because it's exponentially dependent on the band gap, right? So current probability is. And I'll actually post the slides. You can look at it, and you can change it, make it a two-dimensional. This is, I'm talking a little bit about our own research now. Instead of three dimensions, you can make a 2D tunnel diode. You can make 1D and heterodimensional, all that kind of stuff, and see what which one is kind of more attractive for what purpose. And these are these chalcogenide tunneling, you know, in this molysulfide and other things like that. Okay, so there are some articles. I want to skip that now and just say that this is, even though, you know, it's almost been, 60 years people have been studying tunneling, but even today there are, how do I put it, 60 years is not too long in grand scheme of things. So even today, I think experiments are springing up quite a few surprises that, all the most existing theories cannot explain, which is really the beautiful thing that as you probe, this transport mechanism deeper and deeper, you start realizing that, you know, there are some things that were not known before, and it helps in developing condensed matter physics as well. This is kind of a nice little article from Leo Isaki. I think he wrote it two or three years ago, where he says that, so they measure the first tunneling diodes in germanium, and after 50 years they measure it again, and it only has changed by 3%, which is kind of an interesting thing, because you see there's a very high field, and people always are scared that if you have a very high field, you have ions and all that, and, you know, over time things will move, you know, everything diffuses, right? Everything has diffusion. So if ions move and things like that happen, then clearly your field is changing inside the junction, and over time the current should change, right? And that's what and he's trying to say that, at least for the diodes they measured, not much change. So in 50 years at least, not much change. So that's about tunneling. I'm going to kind of stop talking about that and then go over to the next topic. And this is, let me just introduce the next topic, and then on Monday we will get into the depth of it. So again, I now have this little list of things we are doing. We talked about transmission and tunneling, at least some introduction to tunneling FETs. Now what we're going to do is develop this whole NEGF picture. And again, we are going to do it from a perspective of a problem that you run into if you make an experiment, if you do an experiment and it predicts, it shows something that you cannot explain, you know. So here's the experiment. This is kind of nice to look at. Let's look at this experiment. The experiment is, I have two metals. This is very similar to a problem you just solved in your assignment. I have two metals, and I have an insulator in between, right? And I apply voltage across the two metals. What's the current? And you solve that. You have some tunneling probability and all that sort of thing. There's some current. Let's assume, for argument's sake now, that the insulator has a very large band gap, which means the barrier for tunneling for electrons from the metal states on the left to the metal states on the right, which are filled, mu r, chemical potential on left, is very... So barrier is very large, let's say, so that the tunneling current is negligible compared to some other things we're going to talk about now. And then what you do is, it's very large, but what you do now is, you apply a voltage first. So let's say you're, or maybe here. Okay? So I have applied a certain voltage. So this is Q times V, and here are all my filled states, mu r. Let's define the Fermi function, which is the occupation function, right, as a function of energy. And the way I'm writing it is, this is my notation. F of x is 1 over 1 plus e to the power x over kt. Okay. This is my notation, at least. So Fermi function, I'll write it like that. X is basically E minus EF, right? Energy minus Fermi energy. Okay. So on the left side, you can see my Fermi function will be F maybe you can tell me, what will it be? So if this is energy, this is mu L, what is my Fermi function of the left contact? Meaning the left metal, how will it look, right? So, well, that looks, you know, like that, right? How do I write it? F of what? E minus what? Mu L, the left chemical potential, right? That's right. So you have F of E minus mu L, right? And similarly on the right, I have F of E minus mu R, right? Those are the Fermi functions. Now I'm saying that for whatever reason, I have a very large barrier and the tunneling current is very small and no current is flowing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce one state here, just one state, one electron state inside, just one. And how might that be possible? Many ways. I mean, I can take a silicon dioxide and I put in one impurity atom. An impurity atom has many states. It has energy states, say there, energy state there, and here's one state that lies somehow. I managed to put it right inside this window of energies, right? And now ask the question, now tell me what is the current because of this state. This is an empty state. Oh, rather, I'm not making any presumptions. This is a state for electrons. What is the current through here, right? So that's the question we can ask. And that's a well-defined question now, right? So what's the current? You'll get a current in amps through the state. Right? And the way to calculate it is the following. You know, you can, again, I want to go back and look at it from a kind of semi-classical picture. And in the next class on Monday, we'll make it fully quantum mechanical. Okay? So let's first develop it semi-classically. So the way to look at it is, well, I will have, you know, the let's look at this energy. I'm going to assume completely elastic transport. So then this state will be, this metal electrode, all the energy is higher than that, we'll try to fill it. That's pretty clear, right? You want to try to fill it, right? And all the states here are trying to empty it, right? And then they cannot reach consensus, right? I mean, this will keep trying to fill it, that will keep trying to empty it, and therefore there'll be a net current flow outside in the circuit, right? The electron will move, right? Let's just for argument's sake, and the details of these are where quantum mechanics comes in, you know, say that this rate at which is being filled from the left is gamma sub left. That's it, right? Is the rate, 1/s or hertz or, you know, gigahertz or whatever, how fast, right? And rate at which it's emptying on the right side is gamma sub r. You know, these are just rates, gammas. And once I have written this gamma l, gamma r, and the Fermi functions, this is enough. I can write the current completely. And then the way to write the current is the following. So the rate at which the electrons will fill from the left to right. Let's write it this way. The current flowing from the left into this state zero, let's call this zero. State is zero. From the left electrode into zero. What is current? It's always, you know, gamma L is the rate at which it's kind of coupled in and it's filling it, times, so electron charge Q, electron charge times a frequency of filling. But the filling is not free. You cannot do that because these are fermions, right? Electrons are fermions. It makes sense? I mean, already will tell you that the current flowing from the left electrode into the state zero is Q times that times Fermi function, right, of the left electrode. It must be, it must have some states. Otherwise, you know, it cannot suffice. It cannot really do that. So what I'll get here is E. But what E? If it's elastic transport, what E should I be looking at? You know, if it's elastic transport, the energy cannot change when it fills it, right? So I have not defined it. It must be this energy, whatever is that energy. And let's call that energy as E naught here. That energy is E naught. So I get E naught minus mu L, right? That's the Fermi function of the left supply, right? Minus the Fermi function of, let's call it F sub zero. You know, I don't know what is the Fermi function of this. Does that make sense? Actually, no. What did I write here? That's not quite the good way to do it. Let me just write it this way. I wanted to find it as a function of all energies, but okay, F zero of. Okay, that's fine. I don't know what is the occupation function of this, right? But after things have reached, when the current is flowing, this particular energy will have a certain occupation function, which I don't know. That's what I'm trying to say, right? I don't know what the occupation function of this. And similarly, I get from 0 to right will be Q gamma right times F naught, which I don't know, minus F on the right side. Does that at least make sense, at least, you know, from some qualitative, intuitive picture that if F is 1, F naught is 1, no current, right? So if this is filled, that's filled, you cannot fill from here anymore, right? So that's fermion statistics, right? And similarly on the right side. If F is 1 and this is 0, you have the highest chance of filling it, right? So and it will fill. So that's what it's saying. And clearly, if I have a current flowing outside in steady state, these two must be equal, right? These two must be equal. And from that equality, what you get right away is this: what is this occupation function of that state? And you'll find it's gamma left F of E minus E naught minus mu L plus gamma right F of E naught minus mu R over gamma left plus gamma right. That you get right away from here, right? And when you take this, I think I'm kind of out over time now, but if I take this, plug it in back, you see the total current is either this or that, both are equal, right? The current, therefore, is Q gamma L gamma R rates, the product of rates plus, divided by the sum, times F I think you, well, this is not that difficult to get. So you get this. This is the total current flowing through this. And clearly, at least intuitively, everything makes sense. If I have no voltage difference, current is 0. If I have very hard to fill, the rates are very low, I have very low current and all that. Intuitively, it all makes sense. Right? And so you can kind of make a plot of it. And you can see from here that if I make this larger and larger and larger, I can push as much current as I want through it. You know? But when people actually started doing experiments like this, meaning one atomic state or one molecule, and you try to push current through, what they see is I over V for one state is always less than or equal to 2Q squared by H. You know? You cannot go further than that when they experimentally measure it. You know? It's always less than a certain quantity, which is the quantized conductance. For one state, single state, if you want to tunnel through it, and it's always less. But this theory is saying you can get as much. You can get as much conductance as you want as long as you increase this. Right? So what must be true is this is not correct. There's something missing. Right? And what is missing is what we will discuss in the next class. You cannot think of it as a state, which is a single state, if you are coupled to an outside environment. You cannot think of it that way. You must think of it. What happens is this single state, in density of states, you can think of it as a delta function. What will happen is this will become broadened. The density of states instead of delta function becomes broadened. And once you introduce that, you will see right away you cannot get more than that. And that's the idea behind the Green's function. Once you couple an electronic system to outside world very strongly, you change the electronic system itself, which is should be obvious. But you know, all the earlier theories we have developed doesn't take care of that. Okay. So this is the experiment we're going to explain. Meaning, why is it that conductance through single states is less than this certain number? How do you explain it? And the moment you take this into account and you have many states, that's your whole Green's function approach. So at this stage, we are already discussing about this book, and I'm going to refer to you for Dutta's book where he describes it very nicely. And he also has this really nice lecture series videos on the web, so I'll also link you to that. Please append your classes with that. We will look at it in our own way, but we'll make some very nice connection to that picture as well. Anyway, so this is the experiment, and the idea is very simple, but taking it into the quantum version is all the mathematics and details which we'll do in the next class. Then. Okay, good. So we can stop today.